have today. So I think, you know, economics as well as finance, you know, have a big part to play. And I want to say one more, is that why do I focus so much on this, economics and finance? Because they are the so-called foundation upon which, what do you call, policymakers, especially central bankers, and bankers, private bankers, in the private sector, they base their way of thinking, their way of behavior on that. Let me give you an example. Because market is efficient, according to all these people, that market pricing correctly. So a person like Greenspan, as smart as he says, who am I to second guess the market? People told him, no, look, even he himself said, well, there's irrational exuberance and all this stuff. You know, so what should the bankers, central bankers do? They should try to bring down or at least control and regulate inflation, asset inflation, by increasing interest rates and all that. They don't. Because he says, the market is efficient. Okay? So the market knows best. And we know that the market really doesn't know best. But the hypocrisy of these people is, they believe the market is efficient when prices are going up. But when prices are tumbling, Claude, the market is not efficient. Because if the market is efficient, we should have let the prices find their own level. They come in, they pump prime, and then they do all kind of stuff to prop up the market. So I think this is a major hypocritical attitude that these people have.
Could you dwell a little bit on the equality aspect? Because I think that's not being highlighted at all in many of these discussions, particularly the inequalities within the United States economy and compared to other economies, and that implication for the present crisis.
Can I ask you, do it in 10 minutes? Or we just continue. We continue. Okay. Yes, this is actually one of my favorite topic. And I think this is one of the least discussed, aspect. In fact, when I started writing, about the great financial crisis in August of 2007, a month after the collapse of Boston's hedge funds. Okay? And I finished my first article in September of 2007, and was published, I think, in a few months later in the a working paper for the Levy Economic Institute, out of the United States. And the title of that book, that article, is called Old Wine in New Bottle. Basically, a biblical title, That what has happened is really nothing very new, It's actually old stuff, but it put in a new repackaged form. At that time, as I said, very few people believe the crisis is important. In fact, I gave a talk at the Asian Development Bank. At that time, I had left Asian Development Bank. And very unfortunately, then maybe about 20 people came to listen to the talk. And then my former director of the private sector said, oh, don't bother about this. This problem is just a tempest in a teacup. And unfortunately, he's proved wrong. Okay. And I wrote that, inequality is a major problem. And only recently that I found out, that actually the statistics have improved it more. And I have here, can you see this very clearly?
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, this is a chart that goes back 100 years from 1913 to 2007. Okay? It says, the red line shows the level of total income in the United States, that is owned by the top 1% of the top income earners. It shows that in just prior to 1929 crash, the top 1% of the US population or income earners, took home about 22% of the US total income. And then after the crash with regulation and all the stuff and all those new deals, the inequality started to go down. And then it was pretty good at about 10%, the top 1%, was hovering around 10% for about 40, 50 years. And then it started going up again with the deregulation that started in 1970s. And it reached its height again, you know, around just before the crash. And more recently, Nicholas Kristof of New York Times wrote an article which says that the United States is now become a banana republic. And I think he offended a lot of people. But why is it the United States is a banana republic? Because it says the income inequality in the US is equivalent to, or if not worse than, many third world countries like Malaysia, Guatemala, Philippines and all that. If you use economic statistics, they call it the Gini index or Gini coefficient, where inequality is measured in terms, you know, between 1 and 0. 0 is absolute equality, where everybody has the same amount of money, and 1 theoretically is one person has everything and the rest have nothing. So that's the two extremes, which don't happen in reality. In between then is the level of inequality. So United States inequality is around 47 or 0.47. Okay? Malaysia is around 46, 47 too. Okay? And to put it in a different perspective, it means, for example, in 2007, according to Nicholas Kristof, you know, he quoted some statistic, the top 1% got 24% of the total income. Okay? And probably the bottom 20% gets now less than 5%.
How is this linked with the crisis?
Okay, this is linked with the crisis because over the last 30, 40 years, income and growth has been happening tremendously in the US as well as all over the world. But this increase in income, right, has not been matched by an increase in inequality. In fact, it's going the other way. You know, the economy is growing, but income inequality is getting worse. And there is another chart which is, I think, very important, where we see, I don't know if you can see this from my book. Can you see this? Okay. Now, this chart shows you two lines. Okay. The top line, the darker line, shows you the increase in productivity in the US between 1945 to 2007. All right, you see that the two lines, the darker and the lighter line, were moving in tandem, right? And it was together, and then it started to diverge starting from around 1970s. Okay? And became large, the divergence became wider and wider. So what this tells us here is that as productivity is increasing, the wages, the compensation, the lighter line, the compensation is not going up as much. Okay? So to put it another way, much of the increase in growth has been going to capital and labor's share of GDP has been falling. So what does it mean? It means wages are almost stagnant. And this is another interesting chart. Is it okay? Yeah, okay. Right. This chart here, you see this top line?
Okay. Yes.
It shows you the in terms of percentages, the percentage in the CEO's pay, it went up from here to 400%, came down a little bit, and then up to 300%. Now, at the bottom here, you see this flat line? That's the real wages of the production workers. They stayed flat. This is between 1990 to 2005. So if you look any way, you know, you look at the productivity versus wages, you look at CEO pay versus what you call workers pay, you look at Gini index, you know, you look at everywhere, what's happening is that, you know, people are working harder, productivity is increasing, their wages are flat.
They don't have money to buy.
They don't have money to buy, exactly. But if you don't have money to buy, business is not going to grow. Okay? However, the economy in the US or the financial industry, you know, I don't say that it's a conspiracy theory. To resolve this problem is you put in a lot of debt. Right? If you don't have money to buy, what do? I'm a banker, I lend you money. I give you a credit card, I give you home equity loan, you know, I give you cash advances, you know. Hey, why not? I'll take it. And you see another chart that the house yes, this chart. Okay? This chart shows you the increase in debt. This line that's up in there is the total debt of the United States. Okay? The bottom here, which is you can't see so well, are the different types of debt. Right? As a percentage of the GDP. This is between 1960 to 2007. In 1960, the total debt in the US economy is 150% of GDP. By 2007, it's 350%, which means the total debt of the economy went 3 times. Okay? Now, what's more interesting is the financial debt in the US during this period went up 300 times, I think. Okay, and the household debt rose 64 times. Oh no, sorry, the financial debt rose 490 times between 1960 to 2007. The household debt rose 64 times. Okay. And the government debt only rose 24 times. So today, the household debt is 100, almost 100% of the GDP. Okay, that's how, you know, this. So to answer your question here, inequality basically, you know, makes the ordinary people, you know, wages stagnant. And then to increase the consumption, you put on debt. And that shows that, you know, household debt went up 64 times, even though their wages didn't go up that much. That's one side of the coin. The other side of the coin, if most of the people don't get any money, so where did the money go? We already showed, right, that the top 1% cream off 24%. But actually, it's the top 1% of the 1% that creams off the majority, you know, of this stuff. Okay, so they have lots of money put in, economic terms, the propensity or the marginal propensity to save is very, very high. Right? They save and they have to invest. And they're not interested in putting in, you know, fixed deposit, giving you 1%, 2%. They put it in the hands of bankers who come up with all these financial products, derivatives, leverage it, private equity funds, leverage buyout, mergers, acquisition, you name it, they have it. Okay? And this is fantastic.
Wouldn't there be no place to hide for them as well?
Well, exactly. So you have the debt bubble, you have the asset bubble. Correct? And they all have to obey the law of gravity. It goes up, 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 and boom, one day it will come down. So the debt bubble is, you know, imploded. The asset bubble also imploded. You know, when it imploded, they had nowhere to hide. The financial industry must have lost more than $2 trillion, you know. People like, you know, all these big time capitalists and all that, they lost heavy. For example, there was an interview of the owner of the gambling resort Sands, you know, the Sands Resorts. Okay, he used to have, you know, $20, $30, or $40 billion, and then he was reduced to maybe a couple of billion dollars. You know, he says he's poor. I mean, I don't mind having $1 billion. But unfortunately, this guy is coming back again.